This podcast is sponsored by Blue Diamond Garden Centres. Fill your garden with beauty and heritage with the National Trust collection of bulbs, seeds and plants, specially curated by Blue Diamond Garden Centres. Working together for the love of nature.
Hello and welcome to the National Trust podcast. I'm Heather Birkett. In today's episode, we discover how an ordinary incident led to one of the greatest series of thoughts in the history of mankind and the unravelling of the mysteries of the universe. Today, rather than starting our journey in the grounds of a National Trust property, we've made our way to the iconic biospheres and exotic plant collection of the Eden Project in St Austell, Cornwall. Amongst all of Eden's exciting flora and fauna sits a very ordinary-looking apple tree sapling that looks a bit out of place. It's skinny and spindly, and compared to some of its neighbours, looks a little bit plain Jane. But you should never judge a book by its cover, because this sapling has one inspirational story to tell.
3, 2, 1, 0. Engines at maximum thrust. Liftoff.
There's an incredible amount of power, noise and vibration as the engines accelerate to full thrust. There's not a huge amount of acceleration in the first few seconds. It's 300 tonnes of rocket lifting off.
My name is Tim Peake and I'm an astronaut with the European Space Agency.
The date is the 15th of December 2015, and Tim has hitched a ride on the Russian Soyuz rocket on a mission to the International Space Station. Quite possibly the commute of a lifetime.
Quite quickly after leaving the launch pad, that's when the acceleration really kicks in.
You're on the way.
It's far noisier outside the rocket for the spectators who are about a kilometre away. Inside, we have a number of different stages to go through. The first stage will take us up to about 60 kilometres. And then we jettison the first stage boosters. And at that point, we have a really big drop in acceleration as those first stage boosters fall away. It's a much gentler, smoother ride on the second stage, with just one engine firing. That gets us above the Earth's atmosphere, and that's when the nose fairing jettisons so we can get to see the view of space approaching through the window. And then the third stage kicks in, and that is pure acceleration. Up to about 4 Gs of acceleration. It just goes on and on and on. The whole launch sequence lasts for nearly 9 minutes. The idea, of course, is to get you up to about 220 kilometers at about 25 times the speed of sound. So it's a wild ride. You really are feeling the full force of that rocket's acceleration. And then, you know, within a fraction of a second, the engine cuts out and we're in zero G. Very quiet, very peaceful, and everything floats inside the spacecraft. And you know that you've safely made it to orbit.
Hitching a ride alongside Tim on this mission are the seeds from which the apple tree at the Eden Project grew, and for quite a significant reason. It's a story that you may be familiar with. It all started hundreds of years ago on the 25th of December with the birth of a very special child. Richard Fairhead, National Trust volunteer, explains more.
On the 25th of December, a baby was born surrounded by farm animals. Some chickens, a few pigs, I no doubt, and some fields for vegetables. The main crop, if you can call it a crop, were sheep. In Lincolnshire, of course, sheep and wool were very important in those days. And his mother was very keen that he should take on the farm.
But rather than agriculture, this young man had his mind set on other things.
He was interested in how things worked. He made models. There's one famous model he made of a windmill. He took it out into the field and the wind blew. And it turned the sails, just as it should. And the story goes on that he brought it indoors and began to think, well, it's not going to work indoors, there's no wind. He thought about this for some time and came up with the idea. He made a little treadmill, like you have in a hamster cage, found a real mouse, put the mouse in the mouse did its stuff, and turned the sails. And I think that's an indication of his practical approach to things and his inquisitiveness. And that practical approach to life really saw him through the rest of his life. When he became a teenager, his mother sent him to Grantham, to the King's School.
But school sadly didn't give this young man the kind of education that he needed to feed his inquisitive mind.
They weren't teaching much in the way of science and the sort of things that he was really interested in.
And despite having her mind set on him taking over the farm after school, his mother was eventually persuaded to let him go to university.
In 1661, he went off to Cambridge, to Trinity College.
And even here, he still wasn't able to get the kind of education that he desired. But finally, in 1665, he got his degree. And free to study more autonomously, he was able to research the things that interested him. But this was short-lived.
In 1665, in London, the plague hit, the bubonic plague, and it was beginning to go out to other parts of the country. And they were so worried at Cambridge that if it got there, with all the people meeting in the university, it would be a real disaster. So they took the decision to close the university and sent everybody home.
So our young scientist was sent back to social distance. But far from disrupting his research, lockdown gave him the time and space to immerse himself in his work.
So in about a year and a half, he got started on some of his big ideas. The world changed in that year.
He studied religion and philosophy, experimented with lenses, and was the first to split white light into its rainbow spectrum with a prism. But it was an instance of happenstance while he was relaxing in his apple orchard that would lead to his greatest discovery.
He was sitting underneath the tree, probably reading a book, thinking about some theory he was following up. And as apples do, one of them fell down beside him. And I guess he was a bit startled. He looked up to see where the apple had come from. And he began to think, what makes things fall directly to the earth? Is there some sort of attraction? Is there some sort of force which is involved? And of course, he thought about this over the years to come, and in time came up with this whole theory of his about gravity.
So in case you haven't guessed it yet, the man we're talking about is Sir Isaac Newton, and the property, the National Trust's Woolsthorpe Manor, still home to Newton's apple tree. His theory of gravity is something we now take for granted. But in the 1600s, according to Dr. Cornelius Schildt, postdoctoral scholar at Oxford, this realization had a monumental impact.
It changed the world of mathematics and the world of natural philosophy to such a degree that the entire 18th century, so the following century, was basically designed as a confirmation of what Newton had written.
However, despite the revolutionary impact of Isaac's encounter, gravity may not have been something that occupied many of his thoughts.
He's much more interested in optics. He makes his own reflecting telescopes. He's not really thinking about gravity.
But for some reason, in 1684, 20 years after his apple inspiration, suddenly his thoughts once again turned to gravity.
Out of the blue, he drops everything that he's doing. And he starts writing the Principia.
The Principia, or to give it its full name, Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, was a three-volume publication where Newton first described his theory for the universal law of gravitation. But for Newton himself, and for those in his closest circle, his world-changing ideas needed a lot of encouragement to be shared in the first place.
I don't think that he was perhaps as self-confident as automatically assumed that this bright, intelligent mind would be. He needed the help of others to get him where he was.
This is Jenny Johns, part of the team who look after Newton's home at Woolsthorpe.
It's quite understood that he was a difficult person. There's a well-known feud with a fellow scientist, a German scientist called Leibniz, that they had a difficult relationship. Similarly with Robert Hooke at the Royal Society.
To the Newton family, Isaac was forever destined to look after the farm at the manor house that he had inherited.
He was born here as Lord of the Manor since his father predeceased him and spent a lot of time with his grandmother after his mother remarried when he was three. And his grandmother was aware of his position as Lord of the Manor and therefore didn't really encourage him to socialise much with the local children. And it's documented that when he was at school later on as a teenager in Grantham at the King's School, he got into a playground argument with a fellow pupil. And that actually encouraged him to do better in his studies because at the time he wasn't a great student. He was at the bottom of his class, not because he wasn't capable, but he was just distracted by other things and he had other interests. Today, if we would really encourage that and we would be probably really excited to see this mind at work. But of course, back then he was viewed as probably being a bit strange and different. But look what he turned into.
These feuds and fallings out ran as a continuous theme throughout his life. As he matured, the physical fights lessened, but the truculent personality remained. Deep down, Newton was a very introverted person. A biography from Oxford University noting that, even in his maturity, having become rich, famous, laden with honours, and internationally acclaimed as one of the world's foremost thinkers, he remained deeply insecure, given to fits of depression and outbursts of violent temper, implacable in pursuit of anyone by whom he felt threatened. While we can never truly know the inner workings of a person's mind, we can, however, say with some degree of confidence that Newton's was full of ideas, but that he himself felt alone and unable to share them with anyone. That was until he met the astronomer, Edmond Halley. Halley had been working on a theory that there must be a force that allowed planets to be attracted to the sun. A force which allowed for their movement, but with a degree of predictability. Halley had presented his ideas, but they were quickly dismissed without having any mathematical proof. Keen to find a solution, Halley headed for Cambridge, where Isaac Newton was working as a professor of mathematics. The pair had met briefly before in London and had shared some letters theorising the movement of comets, but it was this meeting that set in motion the beginning of the Principia. When presented with the challenge of why planets move in the way that they do, Newton suggested that they were following an ellipse. And furthermore, he had already come up with the calculations to prove it. Halley was stunned and Newton was encouraged. He was now reassured that his thoughts and theories could be met with the praise he knew they deserved. Halley continued to encourage Newton over the course of the next 18 months, and in April of 1686, his works were presented to the Royal Society.
And he presented it to the Royal Society and other scholars, and it was slated, it was heavily criticised. So he said, right, fine, I'll sit on it, I won't publish it, that's it, never talk about it again.
One of the Society fellows, a scientist named Robert Hooke, was leading the claim that this work had been plagiarised, putting Newton into a position he was deeply uncomfortable with. Newton's immediate response was to withdraw and threaten to pull part of his manuscripts away from publication. Some months passed, and thankfully, with some more gentle persuasion and the resolve of his friend Edmond Halley, Newton was finally warmed back to the idea that his thoughts were worthwhile. Robert Hooke's claims were never held up, and in June of the same year, the Principia was given the go-ahead to be published and printed from the Royal Society.
However, tracking back on what the Royal Society was up to at that time, It had, the year before, published a very good book, not as good as Newton's, and that was John Ray and Francis Willoughby's History of Fishes.
This is Keith Moore, head of collections at the Royal Society Library. Although the book had been given the green light, there was no money to pay for it to get through the printers.
The Society's finances were somewhat embarrassed, shall we say. It meant that they couldn't afford to print Newton's Principia Mathematica. That meant Halley got the job of doing it and paying the costs as well. So Halley is really a scientific hero because he made it possible for Principia Mathematica to appear.
So Principia had finally made it into the world, and with it a brand new understanding of how the universe behaves. Today, we remember Isaac Newton and a chance happening in an orchard for unlocking many of the scientific ideas that we hold in the present. The simple act of an apple falling to the ground became the perfect and understandable symbol of how our planets and stars align under the force of gravity. Pips from Newton's apple tree have now grown into plants of their own in the gardens at the Eden Project, the United Nations in Vienna, and back at home alongside the original at Woolsthorpe Manor. As for Edmond Halley, he used his friend's workings to predict the movement and appearance of one of the most well-known comets in the sky, Halley's Comet. And in case you're wondering, he was eventually repaid by the Royal Society for fronting the costs to have the Principia published in unsold copies of The History of Fishes. Thank you for listening to the National Trust podcast. To find out more about Isaac Newton and his life at Woolsthorpe, please take a look at the links in our show notes. To be the first to hear new episodes, be sure to subscribe or follow this show in your favourite podcast app. And if you like anything that you have heard or want to get in touch, you can reach us by emailing podcasts@nationaltrust.org.uk. We'll be back soon with a new episode. But until next time, from me, Heather Birkett, goodbye.
Fill your garden with beauty and heritage with the National Trust Native Tree Collection, specially created by Blue Diamond Garden Centres. Working together for the love of nature.